we met for breakfast yesterday, or did you? And I just met with a young man. He was a young man. We were all young men at one time. This guy called me, and like 30 years ago, no, more than that, 40 years ago, he was in my youth group in Garden Grove. And he just retired as a colonel in the Air Force. And he said, I just had to call you and come and talk with you. And he wants you and me and him and George. You remember George Sayes?
Yeah, sure.
Do you? Okay. He wants us to do a leadership conference for us. But anyway, it's just God has brought us together in so many ways. And it's been God's blessing. And I hope Mike is a blessing to you today. I trust that he will be. This is his special spiritual gifts. So let's trust God to speak to us.
Did you have a break? You brought water? I was worried for there for a minute because I've never been to a Baptist church that didn't take an offering. I just leaned over to Beth and said, you recovered. That's always good. I appreciate the opportunity to be here with you. I had, last time I was here, I was introducing you to this whole idea of these categorical groupings of spiritual gifts. There's a number of lists in the New Testament that have lists of spiritual gifts. And for years, you know, I used to try to pile them together into 22 or 27 or 19, you know, and kind of go through them. But it never made any sense to me that was the way it was. And then I was introduced to the teaching that I've been sharing with you, where they actually are very different from one another. Those gifts are, those lists represent very different things. I showed you this grouping up there last time, and that first column is out of Romans 12, and that's the grace gifts, or some call it motivational gifts. That in the middle are the ministry gifts. Now this is all out of 1 Corinthians 12. 4 through 6, where it says, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. In other words, varieties of grace gifts. And there are varieties of service or ministry, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, in other words, the manifestations of the Holy Spirit. It says, but the same God who powers them all in everyone. And so, I'm going to realize that, and realize that all those lists actually represent three different categories or three different types of gifts that are there. And that's what we're studying together, is understanding what each one of those categories are, which ones of them that we specifically have. Because 1 Peter 4:10 tells us very specifically, each one, that's you, that's me, that's all of us, have a special special gift. Well, let's talk about this first group that we're going to be talking about tonight, the grace gifts, or this morning. And so if you would turn with me to Romans, the 12th chapter, in verse 3 through 15. I really need to get a, older I get, I need to get a new preaching Bible, because these letters are awfully small. Verse 3 of Romans 12, it says, for through the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think so as to have sound judgment, as God has allotted to each of you a measure of faith. Just as you have many members in one body, we have many members, and all the members do not have the same function. So we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Since we have gifts, again, that the gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, that's the important part, underline that part. We have gifts according to the grace given to us. Each of us is to exercise them accordingly. If prophecy, according to the proportion of his faith. If service, in his serving. Or he who teaches, in his teaching. Or he who exhorts, in his exhortation. He who gives, with liberality. He who leads, with diligence. He who shows mercy, with cheerfulness. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation. Devoted to prayer. Contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and curse not. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Let's pray. Father, we just ask that as we consider these passages this morning, Lord, that you would really give us insight. Lord, that you would allow us to be able to see the wonderful plan you have for each one of our lives. And allow us to be able to see how you want to use us in our circumstances. Lord, no matter what we are doing or what we do during the week, Lord God, you desire to work through us. And Lord, this is just, help us, just help us to see how you desire to use us and give us insight into these things. Illuminate our minds by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I read those last few verses, those last seven verses, and I'll explain why in a few moments. But these gifts are bestowed according to the grace given to us. Again, it's that first group that we want to talk about. And they represent who we are and our basic function in the body of Christ. Each person has one common gift. And then there may be one or more secondary gifts. The essential nature of the gifts does not change very much in our lifetime. But as we mature, we have a responsibility to live out the characteristics of other gifts. Now, again, if you can go back one, we're talking about that first column of grace gifts. Sorry, that manifestation kind of went over into there, the wrong column. But the grace gifts are over there on prophecy, serving, teaching, exhorting, giving, ruling, and showing mercy. Okay? And those are according to the grace that's given to us. What does that mean? That basically means that is how God made you. That's how He made me. There are particular strengths and weaknesses that He's given to you. But there's a purpose behind it. And that's what we want to explore this morning, is to begin to understand which one of those, okay, applies to me. So we'll start with this idea of this prophet perceiver. And the prophet perceiver describes one who declares truth and despises evil, is the simple definition. The qualities of a person like this is they can very quickly discern between right and wrong. This is a black and white person. This is a person who gray just kind of doesn't exist. They'll say, this is right or this is wrong. And there's no gray area in between. Generally speaking, this person would be someone with this gift would be very persuasive. They're really good. They're generally good public speakers. Yard to go on. And so they're good public speakers. And they have good leadership qualities. They're very intuitive kinds of people. They make snap judgments. These people drive me crazy sometimes because when I know that people around me and what their gifts are, and we'll be in a meeting and they'll just right away pop right up with a response to a given circumstance. And I'm sitting there going, oh, wait a minute, we gotta look at this. We gotta, I'm ready for this, you know, because they can make those kinds of intuitive snap judgments that some of the rest of us just are not able to do or are uncomfortable doing. Remember last time I talked about the fact that there are things that whenever you look at people around you that you realize, wow, they have such an easy we'll talk about it. She'll talk about it. She says, oh, I need somebody to organize this. But I just can't do it because it's not one of her strengths. Okay, that was her way of saying, get in there and organize it. Your wife never did that to you, though, right? Just kidding. This person is typically a very strong-willed person, and as a result, they become kind of overly opinionated, and that can be good, that can be frustrating, and so it's a very confident person. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that I read those last seven verses of Scripture about Romans, starting with verse 9, and here's why. Paul actually employs a common rabbinical teaching method called a string of pearls. In other words, it was very common for a rabbi to be teaching and to give a list of something. And he'll say several things, like Paul did here. He talked about these seven grace gifts. Well, then what they do is they immediately follow that up with a specific and sequential exhortations or some kind of teaching that relates to that list. Everybody follow me? Now, here's the example of it. In this case, we're talking about the prophet perceiver. And so verse 9 applies to the prophet perceiver. Okay, the first one on his list. And he says, let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. You talk about the fact, by definition, there's someone who declares truth and hates evil. Hold fast to what is good. And so that's an exhortation to the prophet perceiver. Now, just to help you out a little bit along the way here, to recognize one of these or understand what this person is like. If seven people were representing seven grace gifts were to visit a sick friend in the hospital, they might respond in the following manner. How will a proper perceiver respond? What's God trying to tell you is perhaps there's some sin in your life? Would be their question. How about a server? Server is one who demonstrates love by meeting practical needs and especially enjoys manual tasks. This is a person who, among other things, actually is very good at remembering specific likes and dislikes of people around them. Now, I'll tell you what, DJ and Bev and I have been blessed by one of the great servers of all time. And that's DJ and Bev's mom, who recently passed away. That woman was the very definition of someone who serves. She could remember what you like, what you don't like. She loved doing short-term tasks. She could sit down and you give her a task, a job to do, and boy, she would knock it out. And a lot of times she would be doing jobs, and that's the way that servers are, that they would do jobs that others just didn't want to do. They just have this get her done attitude. That's the way they are. And the other thing about them is they have tremendous stamina. There's another gentleman that one of the churches that DJ was talking about in Garden Grove that we were at together. Lewis Covey, that man, he could work. You know, we have all the young bucks now. Mind you, I was in my 20s then, so I was a young buck then. That was a long time ago, obviously. And he could work me under the table any given day doing anything. He'd go out with a lawnmower and mow a 1-acre lot behind the church by himself. I'd go out there and try and help him. Well, I'm dead after about 20 minutes. And he's out there and he just finishes the whole thing. And it's like the stamina that a server has to do that task, that short-term task, and is just remarkable. And they like to work behind the scenes. Don't bother them with red tape. We sit around sometimes in a church meeting, and I'm sure you guys have never done this, but we'd be the subject of death. And I remember one time we were sitting talking in a meeting about something that we wanted to do for the church. And after about an hour of that, Bill got up, walked out, went out, bought it, brought it back, and said, okay, that's done. We don't have to talk about that anymore. Because he doesn't want to waste the time. It's like he works behind the scenes, and he'll just get it done. Doesn't want to discuss it until he dies. And I love this because the beauty of a server is in verse 10 of this passage where it says, love one another with brotherly love. Outdo one another in showing honor. And if you're going to serve others, you have to honor them. And that is what I love about servers, because they view people in a wonderful way. No matter what their background is, no matter where they came from, they don't care. They want to serve them and they want to help them. That is visiting that sick friend, you know, that server who's visiting that sick friend, and you know, they're the ones that would respond to the circumstances and just say, don't worry, everything's taken care of at home. Because they would just come to the need, meet the need, and they would step up and take care of things on the home front while the person's in the hospital. How about a teacher researcher? This is someone who loves to research, validate, and clarify truth. Some of their qualities are an unquenchable desire for knowledge. They will take in information from virtually anywhere just to be able to increase their database of knowledge. And that's what the teacher is like. And the thing is that they also love research. Now, for a lot of you, that sounds like a pretty sick and warped thing. But a teacher loves to research. They love to go dig it out, research it, and learn about it on their own. Okay? And they're typically good listeners. But again, why are they listening? It's because they're taking in information. They're adding information to their knowledge database. And they're typically question askers. If they're attending a conference, they want to know the credentials behind the person that's up there. So they'll ask a lot of questions to kind of figure out, does this guy really know what he's talking about? And that's pretty common. That's what they'll do. They're very dependable. And in verse 11 it says, do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Why? Well, because you know what? You would never see all of what they do when they're alone and preparing for whatever it is they're preparing for. You would only see part of it. And so with a teacher has to really take the attitude of I'm serving God in what I'm doing. And doing the research, spending the time, learning all that they can learn about a given subject, and then get up. And maybe they then have the opportunity to share that. But you know what's most important to them? Isn't the sharing part, it's the research part. That's what they love doing. Sitting at home, sitting in the library, sitting at whatever it is to learn. That's what, you know, really gets them excited. Now, I know that sounds kind of boring, but that's the way it is. But what happens whenever they visit that sick friend in the hospital? What's their station? I studied all about your illness. So, if you have somebody that comes and says, well, I went on the internet and I researched all your illness and everything, they probably have a motivational or a grace gift of teaching, because that's what they do. How about an exhorter, encourager? It describes someone who stimulates the faith of others, most often by giving practical steps of action. People that have this kind of Grace Gibb are making really good counselors. Why? Because they're really great listeners. They're someone who genuinely, they make you, have you ever run into people that make you feel like you're the only person in the room when you talk to them? That person is probably an absorber encourager because they can block everything else out. They can be in a room of 100 people, but yet they make you feel special. They're good listeners. And they're always, now, this is the part that kind of bothers me a little bit about them, and that is that if they hear, you know, life's going kind of hard for you, you know, they get real positive about the adversities of life. Praise God, let's see what God's going to teach you. I heard one guy speak one time, and he said, if you ever hear of me going through these, you know, trials and persecution and difficulties, he said, rejoice! And, you know, and it's like, I'm going, okay. And he goes, because out of it is going to come fresh teaching and experiences with God that I'm going to be able to share. I thought, dude,